Amen. Thank you so much, Brother David. If you are a guest with us tonight, we have been teaching through the book of Joshua for several weeks, so I invite you to open your Bibles to the book of Joshua. Find chapter 4 tonight. The life and legacy of Joshua is what I have entitled this particular study. And last week, we were trying our best to look at chapters 3 and 4 together. And I ran out of time before I ran out of material. And so we had to stop at the conclusion of chapter 3. I wanted to get those two chapters together because really in chapter number 4, it's just a continuation of what happened in chapter 3. And there were only about 2 points there that I wanted to bring out from those 24 verses of chapter 4 before moving into chapter 5. And you know, at this particular point, chapter 3 was that amazing chapter where God had led his children across the Jordan River. Miraculous divine intervention by God had allowed them to walk over on dry ground. It was an amazing feat of the Lord. And then we get into chapter number 4, and there are 2 points that I want to make here, and I want to read some of these verses together, and then we will move on into chapter 5. But a point that he makes in the first 10 verses of chapter 4, and then moving on over into verse 21 through 24, is that he instructed them that after this amazing, miraculous work of God, that they were to take some time and they were to remember God's goodness. It seemed to be a point that he was making time and time and time again, that for their future blessing and benefit, they had to spend some time meditating on remembering God's goodness. Look in chapter 4, beginning at verse number 1, and we'll see how he points out that they were to remember. Verse 1 says, "And it came to pass when all the people had completely crossed over the Jordan, that the Lord spoke to Joshua, saying, Take for yourselves 12 men from the people, one man from every tribe, and command them, saying, Take for yourselves 12 stones from here, out of the midst of the Jordan, from the place where the priest's feet stood firm. You shall carry them over with you, and you shall leave them in the lodging place where you are to lodge tonight." And we know when we get into chapter 5 that that was a place that was called Gilgal. And verse 4 says, "And so Joshua called the 12 men whom he had appointed from the children of Israel, one man from every tribe. And Joshua said to them, Cross over before the ark of the Lord your God into the midst of the Jordan, and each one of you take up a stone on his shoulder, according to the number of the tribes of the children of Israel, that this may be a sign among you when your children ask in time to come, saying, What do these stones mean? Then you shall answer them that the waters of the Jordan were cut off from before the ark of the covenant of the Lord. When it crossed over the Jordan, the waters of the Jordan were cut off, and these stones shall be there for a memorial to the children of Israel forever." And the children of Israel did so, just as Joshua commanded, took up the 12 stones from the midst of the Jordan, as the Lord had spoken to Joshua, according to the number of the tribes of the children of Israel, and carried them over with them to the place where they lodged, and they laid them down there. And then Joshua set up 12 stones in the midst of the Jordan, in the place where the feet of the priest who bore the ark of the covenant stood, and there they are there until this day. So the priest who bore the ark, they stood in the midst of the Jordan until everything was finished that the Lord had commanded Joshua to speak to the people, according to all that Moses had commanded Joshua and the people, and they hurried and crossed over. Now, down in verse number 21, it says, "And then he spoke to the children of Israel, saying, When your children ask their fathers in time to come, saying, What are these stones? Then you shall let your children know, saying, Israel crossed over this Jordan on dry land. For For the Lord your God dried up the waters of the Jordan before you until you had crossed over, as the Lord your God did to the Red Sea, which he dried up before us until we had crossed over, that all of the peoples of the earth may know the hand of the Lord, that he is mighty, and that you may fear the Lord your God. The remembrance of God's goodness. God had been so good to them and so gracious to them in leading them to this point, because they were about to finally experience the inheritance that God had promised them 500 years earlier. And they were finally to that point where they were about to possess the land. Now, it would take great faith. Remember back in chapter 1, verse 5, when the Lord had called and commissioned Joshua, and he told him to be strong and of good courage. Well, in order for them to go into the land, enter the land, and conquer the land, it was going to take great courage on their part, but it was also going to take great faith on their part. And it's fascinating to me that when they arrived at this place and they were about to go in and take possession of the land, the first thing the Lord told them to do is, now, I want you to remember. In fact, they set up two memorial reminders, two things that would jog their memory, that would remind them of what God had done for them as they were crossing over the River Jordan. They were going to be faced with challenges like they had not seen before. There was going to be enemies that would confront them and try to stand in their way. So they had to have great faith to accomplish the feat. And God, interestingly, said, what you need to do to help maintain your faith is you need to remember. Now, that led me to think about maybe the reason God did that is because the greatest threat to faith is forgetfulness. And if we have a bad memory, then that can really have an impact upon our faith. It's kind of like a marriage. You know, the success of a marriage, the greatest threat to that marriage may not be infidelity, but the greatest threat may be just a forgetfulness of the preciousness of the spouse that God has given to you. And so what you do over a period of time is you just begin to take that spouse for granted, and you forget about how special that they are and that they are God's gift to you. And maybe we kind of see the same thing here that is going on, that their greatest threat to their faith and their trust in God was for them to forget what God had done for them. And it's also interesting that Joshua points out, now, I don't want you to just remember this, but I want you to teach this to your children. Teach your children about the mighty acts of God. And I tell you, we live in a culture and a society today where I would say that the greatest thing is needed today from Christian parents is to teach their children about the things of God. It's not really the church's responsibility, certainly isn't the school's responsibility, but it's the parents' responsibility to teach their children about how mighty that their God is. There's something else that, at least to me, is quite interesting here. The fact that they were to remember that day. Did you notice that in the text? I want you to remember that day. You remember the day that God supernaturally intervened and brought you across the Jordan River. It was at flood stage. It was about a mile wide. I mean, it was as turbulent as the mighty Mississippi or more. And yet, God intervened. God stopped the flow of the water about 2 miles up, dammed it up, and then the waters just piled up on either side, and they walked across on dry ground. He said, now I want you to remember that day. Now, why did he instruct Joshua to remember that day? Well, to me, what that says is that God doesn't do that kind of work every day. You know, if God performed those kind of miracles every single day, if God were to give them another Jordan experience 2 weeks later or a month down the road, they wouldn't have to remember that day because they would have been experiencing it on another day. So I think there's something very important there for us to kind of flesh out and to think about, and that is when it comes to the average Christian life, the average Christian life is not a life where we live and we just see great miracles of God every single day. That's not what it's like. And a person that's expecting the Christian life to be that kind of life, they're going to end up disappointed. It just doesn't happen that way. As a matter of fact, there are those who teach that that really is what the Christian life is all about. Every single day, seeing all of these miracles, at the end of the day, it doesn't happen that way, so they end up making up stuff that aren't miracles of God. So he said, you remember that day, that you saw a miracle of God. Then when you get over in to possess the land and you are conquering these cities, and you face this great opposition, and it looks kind of bleak for you, just go back and remember that day, and remember what God did for you that day. Now, friends, I want to say this as kindly as I know how to say it and can say it, but if it requires a miracle a day to maintain our fidelity to God, then we are a lot less spiritual and a lot more carnal than we thought that we really were. If that's what it takes, you know, if I've got to see a miracle every day, I wonder if I never saw one more miracle, if I would be just as faithful to God. I wonder if all that I had was just my Bible, the objective truth of God to read, where He communicates to me His love for me and He communicates to me His plan and His will for my life. And He guides me and directs me through His written word. If that's all I had, and there were no goosebumps, no jump up and down experiences, would I be just as faithful to Him? If not, then I'm a lot more carnal than I thought that I was. And so He said, I want you to remember God's goodness. But then there is a second thing I want to take note of, and that is in this chapter, the date of God's action. The date of God's action. Verse number 19 of our text. Now, the people came up from the Jordan, mark this, on the 10th day of the first month. And they camped in Gilgal on the east border of Jericho. We just read right over that and we don't even take notice. It was on the 10th day of the first month. Back in the book of Exodus chapter 12. Remember when the children of Israel were getting ready to leave Egypt? That was their last night there. They were preparing that Passover night. And in Exodus chapter 12, the Bible says in verse 1, Now the Lord spoke to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, saying, This month shall be your beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year to you. Speak to all the congregation of Israel, saying, On the 10th of this month, every man shall take for himself a lamb according to the house of his father, a lamb for his household. So that was the beginning of their deliverance. Here, when we get over to the book of Joshua, we read about an event that happened on the very same day of the month, and that was the conclusion of their deliverance. And what we see here to me is an amazing thing. What had happened 40 years before that had begun to prepare them for going out of Egypt by setting apart the Passover lamb, now that day had marked the beginning of their redemption, and now we see the conclusion of it. And I think that there is a tremendous principle being taught there, and that is what God had started, God brought to completion. And so for the Jewish people, when they thought about that 10th day of the month and those two significant events that happened on the 10th day of the month, they would be reminded of God's faithfulness to His word, because it was written across the Jewish calendar. And every day they came to that date, they would be reminded of that. Kind of reminds me of Philippians chapter 1 and verse 6, He who began a good work in you will complete it. So when we put chapter 3 and chapter 4 together, we see God's mighty acts that are being highlighted in these two chapters. And what was the purpose of that? Verse 24 of chapter 4, that all the peoples of the earth may know the hand of the Lord, that it's mighty, that you may fear the Lord your God forever. So these mighty acts of God, then what were the purpose for them? Number one is for all people, both believers and unbelievers, that they might see the mighty acts of God and know that God is a mighty God. But it had a second purpose, that was for the people of the Lord, that you may fear the Lord your God forever. When we see those mighty acts of God, things that only God can do, what should it do? It should produce a deep fear or a holy reverence in our hearts for the greatness of our amazing God. So switch chapters now and go to chapter number 5. And we're going to try to get through as much of this as we possibly can, because when we get to the next chapter, chapter 6, and that is the conquering of Jericho, we're going to need a full hour to be able to get through all of those verses. But as we move into chapter 5, we know that they crossed over the Jordan through the miraculous intervention of God, and we know that they were camped, according to chapter 4, the end of that chapter, about 3 or 4 miles on the eastern border of Jericho. So they were camped right outside the city of Jericho. Now think about this. Common sense would tell you that if they had come through and crossed over the River Jordan, man, they had momentum behind them. They had seen God do a mighty work. And all of the inhabitants of Jericho, the first place that they were going to capture, to conquer, to claim their inheritance, and they had seen the mighty acts of God. They knew what was going on. Common sense would tell you, man, while you've got this momentum on your side, you just need to move right on in and conquer the city of Jericho. The amazing thing is that's not what happened. That's not what God told them to do. Because as Isaiah the prophet says, sometimes God's ways are not our ways, and God's thoughts are not our thoughts. As a matter of fact, the events of chapter 5 took at least 10 days. Some scholars say up to 14 days. So they crossed over the Jordan. They're 3 or 4 miles outside of their first city to capture, their first obstacle in their way for their inheritance. And yet they wait anywhere from 10 to 14 days before they go in and they take possession of the city of Jericho. Now, to me, that defies all human logic, defies common sense, makes no sense at all. But God's ways sometimes are not our ways, and God's plans certainly sometimes are not our plans. See, I really believe that something very important that they had to learn before engaging in battle, and we got to learn the same thing too, and that is preparation is everything. And so for that 10 to 14 days, God was preparing them to go into battle. Preparation's everything. I don't know about you, but I really believe that we're living in a day and time in which that hinders so many people, because they're just not willing to take the time to prepare. They just want to jump right in and do something. I remember when God called me to preach, the first thing on my agenda that God led me to do was prepare. I had not been raised in church. I had very little, quote, religious background and Christian background. I knew that I needed to prepare. And so I had a good plan. I lived in Hilliard, Florida. I owned a tire store. I lived about 30 miles from Jacksonville. My plan was, well, I will go and I will enroll at the University of North Florida. I can keep my tire business I can continue to work that for a couple of years, and I can do my studies, and I can get rid of all of the secular courses there at the University of North Florida. That's what I wanted to do because it made good sense to me. I knew I had to prepare, but at that point, I was following my own plan. So I went down to UNF, I enrolled, I wrote a check for the registration, and on the way home, the Spirit of God so clearly spoke to my heart, that's not my plan, Craig. So when I got home, I called the registrar, I canceled the check, and then God led me to the Baptist College of Florida in Graceville. Now, I am so glad I did that because while being there, I met the most godly man I've ever known in my life who would become my pastor, and I would serve on his staff, a man by the name of Wallace Russell, who became my spiritual mentor. God was wanting me to prepare, but God was wanting to put me in the place that could best prepare me. And so he changed my plans, and instead of going to school in Jacksonville, I ended up, of all places, in Graceville, Florida. I don't think even God can find Graceville. It is out in the middle of nowhere. And so I ended up there, and I prepared. You know, no sports team plays the game without, first of all, preparing. No student takes an exam, or at least they shouldn't, without preparing, without studying. Our choir and orchestra, man, on Sunday, they knock our socks off. They are good, but they don't just walk up in the choir loft and do that stuff. They prepare. They're over there for an hour tonight practicing stuff that they will sing tomorrow. They've been rehearsing for probably the last month. Preparation is everything. So God's people, they crossed over the River Jordan, but then God had them wait for 2 weeks before giving them their first victory. Why did God do that? Listen carefully. Victories require preparation. And the fewer victories that we have, probably the less preparation that we have. Because the more we prepare, the more victories that we are going to see. And it's interesting to me that as we get to chapter 5, that the preparation did not involve military training. Now, they were about to go to war, but the training wasn't military training. The training, as we will see, was spiritual training. You know, I'm sure at this time that those that were living in Jericho, I'm sure they were scared to death. They had seen what had happened at the Jordan. They were thinking, man, what's Israel's next move? What is this amazing God of Israel? What is going to be his next step? And then verse number 1 opens with what I would call an unalterable truth. In chapter 5, verse 1, and so it was that when all the kings of the Amorites who were on the west side of the Jordan and all of the kings of the Canaanites who were by the sea, when they heard that the Lord had dried up the waters of the Jordan from before the children of Israel until we had crossed over, that their heart melted and there was no spirit in them any longer because of the children of Israel. In other words, what they had seen God do for his people had sucked all of the wind out of their sails. And the last thing that they wanted to do at this point was to go to war with this group of people called the Israelites who had a God whose name was Yahweh. See, when you hear about a God who dries up a river and makes a way for his people to cross over, then you take notice. The unalterable truth is that when God acts, people notice. Hear that? When God acts, people notice. Are people noticing what's going on the college campuses across our land? Yeah. Anytime God acts, people notice. But before God ever brought them into Jericho to conquer that city, and oh, by the way, let me just give you a little preview here. We get to chapter 6. How many of you have ever heard the song, Joshua Fought the Battle of Jericho? Well, I'm going to blow your mind. Joshua didn't fight the battle of Jericho. And I'll prove it to you, but you're going to have to wait until we get to chapter number 6. So, and before God took him there, God prepared him, Joshua and his people. And in verses 1 through 9, we see the preparation of consecration. The preparation of consecration. We read in verse number 1 how that the people around them had heard what God had done. They were terrified. They basically wanted to run and hide. And then in verse number 2, it says, at that time, the Lord said to Joshua, make flint knives for yourself and circumcise the sons of Israel again the second time. The first time the men were circumcised was, what, 40 years earlier. Now verse 3, so Joshua made flint knives for himself. And just in case you're out there thinking, what in the world does any of this have to do with me? Just hold on for a second, okay? So Joshua made flint knives for himself, and he circumcised the sons of Israel at the hill of the foreskins. And this is the reason why Joshua circumcised them. All of the people who came out of Egypt who were males, all the men of war had died in the wilderness on the way after they had come out of Egypt. For all the people who came out, they had been circumcised. That's that first generation that were led out of Egypt, heading supposedly to the promised land. They had been circumcised. But all the people that were born in the wilderness on the way as they came out of Egypt, they had not been circumcised. For the children of Israel walked 40 years in the wilderness till all of the people who were men of war who came out of Egypt were consumed, because they did not obey the voice of the Lord, to whom the Lord swore that he would not show them the land which the Lord had sworn to their fathers, that he would give us a land that was flowing with milk and honey. Then Joshua circumcised their sons, whom he raised in their place, for they were uncircumcised, because they had not been circumcised on the way. And so it was that when they had finished circumcising all of the people, that they stayed in their places in the camp until they were healed. That's why there was that 10 to 14 day break. Verse 9, and then the Lord said to Joshua, this day I have rolled away the reproach of Egypt from you. That was what the circumcision pictured. And therefore the name of the place is called Gilgal, which means literally to roll away, until this day. The preparation of consecration. Now, there are two things about this preparation that I want us to see tonight. Number one was the renewal of their covenant relationship. That's what we read about in verses 2 through 7 about the circumcision. There was a renewal of their covenant relationship. They had a covenant relationship with God. That relationship had been broken through disobedience and rebellion and not going in and possessing the land, rejecting the word of God at Kadesh Barnea. And so they had to pause at Gilgal before they went on into Jericho and began to take possession of their inheritance, and they had to submit to some rather painful surgery. Now the question is, why did God command this ritual at this particular time? Because his covenant relationship with his people needed to be reviewed. Now listen, I know that this is going to get a little detailed, but I want to ask you to stay with me, because you cannot understand this passage apart from understanding what I'm about to show you. Israel was, and Israel is, a covenant nation. Did you know that that covenant nation status is a privilege that God has given to no other nation? Not the United States of America, not any other nation. We read about that in the book of Romans, chapter 9, verses 4 and 5, where Paul writes and he says, they are Israelites, to whom pertain the adoption, the glory, the covenants, the giving of the law, the service of God, and the promises, of whom the fathers, and from whom, according to the flesh, Christ came from them, who is over all, the eternally blessed God. Amen. No other nation has been given the adoption, the glory, the covenants, the giving of the law. No other nation did Christ come from that nation. There was this special covenant relation between the nation of Israel and between God. And that covenant at this point, before they pursued their inheritance, that covenant had to be renewed. Remember that God gave the covenant. Now, walk with me through these verses, if you will. In Genesis chapter 12, you know these verses, but I want to read them because I'm going somewhere with this. In Genesis chapter 12, that's where we read the story about God making a covenant with Abraham. And he did that by calling him, remember, out of the land of Ur of the Chaldees. So when he called him out of the land of Ur, he began to make that covenant. Genesis 12, 1. Now the Lord said to Abram, get out of your country, from your family, from your father's house. Go to a land that I will show you. That's the land that they're about to enter into. Go to a land that I will show you. I will make you a great nation. I will bless you. I will make your name great. You shall be a blessing. I will bless those that bless you. I will curse those who curse you. And in you, all of the families of the earth shall be blessed. So here we see the beginning of that covenant. And then we move a little further through the book of Genesis. We get to chapter 15. We see that God sealed that covenant. And he sealed that covenant with a sacrifice. And this is one of the most amazing covenant sealings that we find anywhere in the Old Testament. Genesis 15, verse 1, and after these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision, saying, don't be afraid, Abram, I am your shield, your exceedingly great reward. But Abram said, Lord God, what will you give me, seeing that I go childless, and the heir of my house is Eliezer of Damascus? I know that you have made this promise to me that from me, from my seed, all of the families of the earth are going to be blessed. But Lord, I got a problem. Have you not noticed I'm approaching the century mark? I don't have any children. Verse 3, and then Abram said, look, you've given me no offspring. Indeed, one born in my house is my heir. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him, saying, this one shall not be your heir, but one who will come from your own body shall be your heir. And I can just imagine Abram thinking, really? And then he brought him outside and he said, look now toward heaven and count the stars, if you're able to number them. And he said to him, so shall your descendants be. Wow. And Abram believed in the Lord and he counted it to him for righteousness. Man, that's one of the greatest acts of faith in the entire Word of God. God just brings him out, says, look up in the skies. That's how many kids you're going to have, Abram. And you're almost 100 years old. And he believed the Lord and he counted it to him for righteousness. And remember, by the way, Paul uses that same verse over in the book of Galatians to delineate between how God justifies people. Is it through faith or is it through works? And then verse 7, then he said to him, I am the Lord who brought you out of Ur of the Chaldees. Remember, I spoke to you back then to give you this land to inherit it. The land that we're talking about in Joshua. That's where it ties it all together. And he said, Lord God, how shall I know that I will inherit it? So he said, and here is the sacrifice where he sealed the covenant. And he said, Lord God, how shall I know? So he said to him, bring me a three-year-old heifer, a three-year-old female goat, a three-year-old ram, a turtle dove, a young pigeon. And then he brought all of these to him, and he cut them in two down the middle, and he placed each piece opposite the other, but he did not cut the birds in two. Now, that was a common practice when two parties made a covenant one with another in that day. They would take an animal, they would cut it in two. They would put one side on, they would put one side of the cut animal on one side of the path, one on the other side, and they would walk in between those two halves that they had cut. And that was simply a way of saying that may this happen to us. May we be cut to pieces if one of us breaks this covenant. So he laid out those two halves, and verse 11 says, and when the vultures came down on the carcasses, Abram drove them away. Now here's the interesting point. Now when the sun was going down, a deep sleep fell upon Abram, and behold, horror and great darkness fell upon him. So God gave him the promise, and then God put him to sleep. He falls asleep, and then he said to Abram, know certainly that your descendants will be strangers in a land that is not theirs. They will serve them, and they will afflict them 400 years. That was their experience in Egypt. And also the nation whom they serve I will judge, after they shall come forth out with great possessions. Now as for you, you shall go to your fathers in peace. You shall be buried at a good old age. But in the fourth generation they shall return there, for the iniquity of the Amorites is not yet full. And it came to pass that when the sun went down and it was dark, where's Abraham? He's asleep. There appeared a smoking oven and a burning torch that passed between those pieces. Now, that is so huge because Abraham had nothing to do with the covenant. He's asleep. He can't do anything. This smoking torch and burning that we see here, what is that a picture of? The presence of God. The presence of God and the presence of God alone walked through these sacrifices. And what that was pointing out was, listen, the covenant I'm making with Israel, that they are going to inherit their land. It is totally up to me to make it happen. That is an unconditional covenant that I'm making with my people. So God made that covenant. You see now why it was that God's word came to pass? Why on the 10th day of the month that it happened precisely as God said it would happen? Because God keeps his word. So God makes this covenant with Abraham. God seals it with a sacrifice. And then he provides circumcision as the sign of that covenant. Genesis 17, verse 9. And God said to Abraham, as for you, you shall keep my covenant, you and your descendants after you throughout your generations. This is my covenant, which you shall keep between me and you and your descendants after you. Every male child among you shall be circumcised. You shall be circumcised in the flesh of your foreskins, and it shall be a sign of the covenant between me and you. He who is 8 days old among you shall be circumcised, every male child in your generation. He who is born in your house, bought with money from any foreigner who is not your descendant, he who is born in your house and he who is bought with your money must be circumcised. My covenant shall be in your flesh for an everlasting covenant. And the uncircumcised male child who is not circumcised in the flesh of his foreskin, that person shall be cut off from the people because he's broken my covenant. Guess what? Everybody, every male that was about to enter into the promised land had not been circumcised. That is why this had to happen. Down in verse 23 of Genesis 15, so Abraham took Ishmael, his son, all who were born in the house, all who were bought with his money, every male among the men of Abraham's house, and circumcised the flesh of their foreskins that very same day as God had said to him. Abraham was 99 years old when he was circumcised in the flesh of his foreskin. And I want to write in the flyleaf of my Bible, ouch! Exclamation point right there. And Ishmael, his son, was 13 years old when he was circumcised in the flesh of his foreskin. That very same day, Abraham was circumcised, and his son Ishmael, and all the men of his house, born in the house, were bought with money from a foreigner, they were circumcised with him. You see, that was a huge deal. Through this sign, this ritual, they became the marked people of God. That was what set them apart from all of the other people of the land. This meant that they were under obligation to obey God. The mark of the covenant reminded them that their bodies belonged to the Lord, and they were not to use their bodies for sinful purposes. It reminded them that they were a special and a unique and a holy people, which is also brought out in that covenant in Exodus 19, verses 5 through 6. Now, here's what you got to know. They had not practiced circumcision in all of their wilderness wanderings. 38 years, and not one of that generation had been circumcised. All of the older that had been circumcised, that disobeyed God at Kadesh Barnea, that wouldn't go in and possess the land that now God's given to them, they had been circumcised. But not a one of that newer generation had been circumcised. God had suspended his covenant relationship with his people. Now he continued to provide for them. He continued to protect them. He continued to take care of them. But this new generation that had arisen, that was about to experience their inheritance, it was important for them, in God's eyes, for them to consecrate themselves by renewing the covenant relationship. And see, friends, I wish I had time to go into all this stuff. But they couldn't just run into battle, just jump into doing something. They had to be spiritually prepared before they attempted to do it. Let me tell you very quickly that I believe this act of circumcision, that it spoke of several different things. It spoke about a spiritual work in their heart. Deuteronomy chapter 10, verse 16, "Therefore circumcise the foreskin of your heart and be stiff-necked no longer." See, no amount of external surgery could change the heart. And that outward circumcision was a picture of the internal cleansing and surgery and change that God does on the human heart. And what happened through the years to the Jewish people, and boy, this will give you such a greater understanding of the New Testament and the Lord Jesus in dealing with the scribes and the Pharisees of the New Testament. They came to trust in the mark of the covenant instead of the God of the covenant to secure their salvation. And therefore, that is why when we get to the book of Acts, Peter is fighting against that teaching that these Gentiles had to be circumcised before they could be saved, because they took that mark of circumcision and they took it to a whole new level as a sign that one was saved. And they were trusting in the mark rather than the God who gave the mark. You know, we as New Testament believers, we can do the same thing. You know, we can trust in baptism. We can trust in church membership. We can trust in taking Holy Communion and mistakenly believe that, you know, the juice and the cup becomes the literal body and blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. And that is what saves us and keeps us saved. So it spoke of a spiritual work in their heart, but it also spoke of a testing of their faith, a testing of their faith. Down in chapter 5 in verse number 8, it says, "So it was that when they finished circumcising all the people, that they stayed in their place, Gilgal," didn't go to fight in Jericho. "They stayed there until they were healed." Now, think about where Israel was at that time. They were camped in enemy territory. And now every soldier is temporarily disabled. You don't get circumcised as an adult and go to war that afternoon. So every single warrior is laid up. They're in the sick bed. They're healing. What an opportunity for the enemy to attack them. Friend, it took a huge amount of faith. God says you're going to go into the promised land. You're going to conquer all these cities. They're 3 to 4 miles outside of the first major city that they're going to conquer. And God says, oh, by the way, before you go in and start fighting, I want all of you to get circumcised. And they say, what? Lord, you got to be kidding me. We're going to be laid up for days. We can't fight. What was God doing? He was testing their faith. That's what God was doing. He was preparing them to win that victory by testing their faith. Friend, this makes no logical sense by human standards. Last thing you do before going into battle is to weaken your army. But that's precisely what God was doing. You know, often we have experienced great victories of faith, and then God sets up a test. Are you listening to me? There's that great victory, and then boom, God sends a test. That was a great victory, crossing over the River Jordan when it was at flood stage. Mile-wide river, rocking and rolling. And they crossed over it on dry ground. Man, what a great victory. And now God's testing them by telling them they got to be circumcised. After Abraham arrived in the land of promise, what happened? A test. He was confronted with a famine. After Elijah triumphed over Baal, what happened? He was threatened with death by Ahab and Jezebel, 1 Kings 18 and 19. After Jesus was baptized in the Jordan, what happened? The Holy Spirit led him into the wilderness to what? Be tested, to be tempted. Matthew 3, 13 through chapter 4, verse 11. Now, friend, if you have not heard anything else tonight, hear this. Since great victories can lead to great pride, God often allows us to be tested, to be reminded of who we better depend on. And if God's just done something great in your life recently, and you've had a great spiritual experience, hold on. Watch out. A test is almost guaranteed that is going to come. Great victories can lead to great pride. I've seen it happen in churches where God just poured out His Spirit on a church and there were great victories, and all of a sudden the church gets filled with pride. Look at us. Look what we've done. Look what we've accomplished. What happens? God has to send a test to level them down, to humble them, you know. Because God resists the proud, but He gives grace to the humble. And then third, there was a removal of reproach. Verse number 9, and I'm about to close. Verse 9. It says, and then the Lord said to Joshua, this day, because you've been circumcised, I have rolled away the reproach of Egypt from you. Now, what was the reproach of Egypt? I think the reproach of Egypt was that day that they stood at the border of Kadesh Barnea, and Moses had sent out those spies, remember? And 10 of them came back and said, we can't take the land. They're giants in the land. There are walled cities. We can't do it. And God had already told them, well, I've given you the land. And that day, because of their disobedience and rebellion, they were mocked by the Egyptians. And everybody else that stood around and saw what happened. And so this being circumcised was a recommitment, you might say, to that covenant relationship they had with God and being the people of God. And that was rolling away that reproach. Their sin, their reproach, hung over them like a dark cloud. That day as they renewed their covenant relationship with the Lord that was taken away. See, that was a past failure. Let me tell you something about past failures. Past failures always hinder present and future victories until we deal with them as God says. And God told them to deal with their past failure through circumcision. God tells us to deal with our past failures through repentance. And as we repent, God removes those past failures. There's a fourth thing, very quickly, a qualification to celebrate the Passover. They were going to celebrate the Passover in Gilgal. We'll see that the next time that we meet together. And I'll say a lot more about that later, but the only way that these males could celebrate the Passover was to be circumcised. So that's one reason it had to happen. But in closing, I think there's a truth here for New Testament believers. And that truth for New Testament believers that is that all of us have moments in our earthly journey when we need to reconsecrate ourselves to the Lord. I've never met anyone, including myself, that did not come to those times in my life, in my journey, in my walk with God, that I needed to stop and reconsecrate myself to the Lord. See, they had neglected the law of God. They had disobeyed God. And God was not simply content to let them go on into the land until they reconsecrated themselves to Him. They needed to pause. They needed to regroup. They needed to recommit themselves to their true identity. Circumcision did that. It identified them as God's chosen people, a part of the family of God. And there are times when we need to do the very same thing. All of us at one time or another, we begin to drift. We begin to drift. And in those moments, we need to stop, we need to pause, regroup, recommit ourselves to the Lord. I heard a preacher say the other day, I was listening to a guy preach on the radio, and he said that we will not find in the Bible, he actually said this, he said, we will not find in the Bible the idea of someone recommitting themselves to the Lord. And I was writing my study of Joshua, and I said, Bubba, you need to go read the book of Joshua. That's exactly what they did. They recommitted themselves to the Lord. And friend, that's a sweet thing to be able to do. Because every time that we do that, you know what God does? He receives us. He takes us back. He forgives us. We get a fresh start, just like these did. So the preparation of reconsecration. Well, tonight I've said more than I know about circumcision. So we are done with that for the rest of the study. Would you bow with me as we pray together? And Father, thank you for your amazing word. God, thank you for life lessons that we learn from the study of your word, both Old Testament and New Testament as well. Father, I pray that these principles that we have learned tonight would help us, Lord, in this journey through this life in which we are seeking to serve you and to honor you and to glorify you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you.